Thank you, this is Christus, the English program of Vatican Radio. In studio, I'm Carol Cerulli. Today, international pressure mounts for a ceasefire in Lebanon. South Africa's new president gives mixed reviews, and we'll have a full report on Pope John Paul's weekly general audience. Welcome. Syrian President Hafez al-Assad said on Wednesday he would do his utmost to end the fighting in Lebanon. Replying to an appeal for peace by Italian Prime Minister Giulio Andreotti, Assad said he would try to silence the guns and promote as far as possible an inter-Lebanese agreement. The Syrian President's statement follows growing international pressure on Syria to stop the battle with Christian forces in Lebanon. Military sources report that Syrian troops have closed in on four fronts around the Christian enclave in Beirut. And while the blasts of artillery and tank fire faded at dawn on Wednesday, five people were wounded in overnight shelling Tuesday. But with the casualty toll since Tuesday, the six dead and 21 wounded. Appeals for an end to the fighting in Lebanon have been coming from all over the world. In an emergency session late Tuesday night, the UN Security Council called for an immediate ceasefire and new mediation efforts by the Arab League. The ceasefire call was unconditionally accepted by Christian Army Commander Michael Aoun. The UN declaration echoed a plea made yesterday by Pope John Paul. In a voice often cracking with emotion, the Pope called on Syria to stop its shelling of Christian areas. In its plea for a ceasefire, the Pope said the world cannot sit passively watching the genocide in Lebanon. Since fighting intensified last week, Syrian actions have also been denounced by France and the United States. Our Middle East correspondent, Tanya Kamal-Azim, reports on how Syria has responded to the mounting international pressure.
The conflict is escalating because Commander Michel Aoun, the governor of pictures. They express phantasms of travel flying are almost possible. Seeing army units and their allied forces have moved into areas surrounding the Christian enclave in East Beirut. Our own has called on the Lebanese to assist the Syrians, and he said the hour of confrontation was about to begin. This is Tanya from LLD for Vatican Radio.
An anti-apartheid youth leader was shot dead outside his home in the morning in the latest in a series of killings of South African activists. 27-year-old Eric Gamid was shot at close range by gunmen in a passing car. The young activist was freed from detention last Friday after facing a hunger strike with 42 other prisoners. They were protesting being held without charge under emergency rules. Meanwhile, South Africa's new president, SW de Klerk, is promising to reform injustices that prevailed under the previous administration. For some observers, P.W. Botha's steady resignation this week marks the end of an era and could have far-reaching results. But for many government critics, like Anglican Archbishop Desmond Tutu, the political transition has been almost a non-event. As our correspondent, Carmel Rickard, reports from South Africa.
Given the initial success of the decision, GPWs to SWs, the rest stayed the same. They're still oppressed, apartheid remains in force. People with the Vatican Council of Churches had the same response to this week's event. They told me, there's no change. All that has happened is that apartheid has a new face. As far as the Catholic Bishops are concerned, the issue has been put on the agenda for discussion during the week-long plenary session of the conference beginning in Durban on August the 21st. The newly resigned former state president, D.W. Botha, ruled the country in an increasingly authoritarian style, giving way to his famous temper and insisting that his will was carried out. He disapproved of the election of S.W. de Klerk to succeed him as leader of the National Party. The last few months saw growing tension between the two men. When the end came, it was over Botha's allegations that he was not informed of an intended visit before endorsed by the Church. Members of the public insisted to have known and suggested that his memory had been affected by the stroke he suffered some months ago. But they were unable to establish any reconciliation, and Botha resigned after making a damaging speech to the nation on television. One of the most puzzling remaining factors is what kind of man his successor is. The Pope has presented himself as the man who can break through the logjam on reform, and who will move swiftly to ensure change. On the other hand, several former colleagues have described him as far more conservative than P.W. Botha. One former colleague going so far as to say that his obsession was the end of the road for enlightenment in the cabinet. Whichever is more accurate, the Clerk will be a target of renewed appeals to change government policy on a number of issues, including a moratorium on executions. He's also the subject of high expectations by Labour foreign prime, and we have already had discussions with him. He knows that if he fails to deliver significant change, South Africa will face sharply increased sanctions. He also knows that existing sanctions are beginning to cut deep, and that the country's economy is in serious trouble. However, he also has to deal with a strong right-wing threat during the current election campaign. From Durban, South Africa, this is Carmel Rickard for Vatican Radio.
And now let's take a look at what else is happening around the world. Solidarity looks set to break 45 years of communist government control now that it has received the support of two small non-communist parties. Meanwhile, Polish Prime Minister Czesław Kiszczak, who has abandoned his attempts to form a communist-led government, was expected to present his formal resignation to Parliament on Thursday. In Panama, the Bishop's Conference has called for the resignation of the country's de facto ruler, General Manuel Noriega. In a statement signed by all the bishops, they also called for an end to U.S. sanctions. In the Gaza Strip, Palestinian activists called on Wednesday for a two-week boycott of jobs in Israel to protest computerized identity cards for gay workers. Slogans spray painted on walls in the Social Strip urged Gazans to stay away from their jobs starting Friday to defy Israel's efforts to control the workers. An estimated 50,000 Gazans and 60,000 West Bank Arabs work in Israel. In Iran, the parliament showed its radical bent on Wednesday by electing a fiercely anti-Western cleric to the powerful post of Speaker. The election had been expected because of the balance of votes in the parliament, where hardliners favoring American foreign policy and government control of the economy strengthened their hold in April 1988 elections. Meanwhile, incoming Iranian President Ali Rafsanjani, who quit as Speaker on Tuesday, will take the oath of office in Parliament on Thursday. In the Soviet Union, Russian workers in Estonia pressed on Wednesday to press on with a weekend strike amid signs that could spread to the neighboring Baltic republics of Lithuania and Latvia. Concessions by the authorities had failed to end the stoppage in Estonia, called to protest against a new election law which disenfranchises recent immigrants to the republic. The stoppage by the minority Russians is clearly causing concern among the republic's leadership. The weekly Moscow News reported on Wednesday the strike had caused losses of more than $3.3 million. Or curbs human rights abuses under authoritarian regimes, judges and lawyers are increasingly at risk throughout the world. The extent of the threat to their professional activities or even to their lives was disclosed in a new report presented to the United Nations Human Rights Commission. Our correspondent in Geneva, Jordan Martin, has the details.
The report is a disturbing document. It contains the details of 144 judges and lawyers who have been the victims of death or ethnic violence in the past 18 months in 31 different countries, including 34 killed and 37 deposed. In almost all cases, the perpetrators have not been caught. The report says Brazil was an example of inadequate government protection for the judiciary and the legal profession. Over the past decade, hundreds of lawyers giving legal advice to rural workers in land or labor disputes have been harassed, threatened, or killed, mostly by gunmen in the pay of big landowners. One result of the de facto impunity with which they operated was the rural poor had little chance of defending their basic rights. The Geneva Center sent a mission to Brazil in cooperation with the International Movement of Catholic Jurists, and its report will be issued shortly. The Philippines also presented a very troubling situation. There have been attacks on community church, women's and human rights organizations, and the government has not done enough to condemn them or to investigate the possible involvement of the military. In Peru, the war between the government and the Sendero Luminoso, or Shining Path guerrillas, have brought danger for lawyers representing those suspected of terrorism or for lawyers fighting human rights abuses. The threat came from a paramilitary group. In Colombia, at least 20 judges and lawyers have been killed since January last year, again mostly by paramilitary groups. In the Israeli-occupied West Bank and Gaza, 8 Palestinian lawyers have been detained by the Israeli authorities without charge or trial. In Malaysia, the Geneva Center report described the dismissal of the Lord President and 2 judges of the Supreme Court as a severe blow to the rule of law there. The Prime Minister himself has launched public attacks on the judges concerned after the Supreme Court pronounced a number of rulings unfavorable to the government. In relief of the prisoner, the Geneva Center called up the UN to monitor the efforts of lawyers and announced that Judge P.S. Bhagwati, former Chief Justice of India, would have a worldwide campaign to defend the judges and lawyers facing persecution. This is Gordon Martin for Vatican Radio in Geneva.
After a week of negotiations, it's the second since U.S. Treasury Secretary Nicholas Grady's debt reduction plan was unveiled in March. A Mexican agreement was announced last month. The Bank Committee represents creditors that are owed nearly half the Philippines' total debt of $28 billion. Bankers have said on Thursday that the overall package would likely be worth slightly less than the $1.7 billion the Philippines requested when the negotiations began on August 8th. The talks have focused on the Philippines' intention to pursue its program in line with Grady's plan, which includes debt reduction and access to new financing. And by helicopter to Rome on Wednesday to hold his weekly general audience in the Pacific Auditorium. Since the end of July, the Pope has been spending most of his time at a summer residence in Tuxpan and Rosso, a small town about 15 miles south of Rome. But every Wednesday, Pope John Paul comes back to the Vatican to greet the thousands of pilgrims and visitors who are braving the shimmering August heat in Rome. This week, the visitors included groups from countries the Pope will be visiting later this year.
I wish to welcome the groups of pilgrims from Korea and Hungary. More assured of my craft, I find people out of my past and movies who were practiced in a struggle.
Pope John Paul also continued his reflections this week on the new covenant established by Jesus. The Pope said that the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost was a fulfillment of the new covenant.
All the kinds of this speech, new people of God came into history. This new people is the church, the family of those words whom God has occupied in our chief. In the right corner, God chose Israel to be his own possession, his chosen people, through a completely righteous and gracious act of peace of his love. In the covenant, Israel was all who know that she was God's chosen people and was born to the Lord in her and to them.
In the new covenant, the Pope said, it is the Holy Spirit that makes us holy. It is through the Spirit that we are consecrated as members of a chosen race.
You are the gift of the Holy Spirit of baptism. We are labeled to fulfill our vocation, to be members of Christ, the Church, the Lord, the God, and Paul to be there. The holiness of the Church, then, is God's own work. The Church is holy because the Church came to just be made holy, consecrated by the power of the Holy Spirit.
that brings us to the end of today's broadcast. Thanks for joining us, and be sure and tune in again tomorrow for the latest on the Vatican viewpoint and all the day's top news stories. You've been listening to the English program of Vatican Radio. While Baker needs his sister.
No.